Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Welcome to the next session on Organic Chemistry 2. We are studying about the second module, that is reactions of alkyl halide. In the next lecture, lecture number 4, we are actually studying about the nucleophilic substitution reaction part 4. I am Dr. Balaji, currently working as associate professor in the School of Biotechnology at Jawaharlal Nehru University. This project is sponsored by DTH Swayam Prabha, MHRD, New Delhi. The topics that we will be studying in this particular session include rearrangement of carbocations and the factors that affect SN1 and SN2 reactions. The rearrangement involves primary to secondary or primary to tertiary or secondary to tertiary. We also will be studying about 1-2 shift, either hydride shift or alkyl shift will also be studied in this particular session.
Now the next important thing is the rearrangement of carbocation. Even though we had seen only one type of carbocation, that is the tertiary carbocation, here we have another examples of some other ways by which the rearrangement of carbocation actually occurs. Let us take one example, which is a propyl one. The propyl halide, when reacted with a nucleophile, gives isopropyl derivative. So propyl is a n-propyl is a straight chain one. So this becomes a branched one. So how a branched isomer is formed from a linear chain? So this is what we are going to study here. That is what is called the rearrangement of the carbocation. Now we have the H group is getting shifted from this carbon to the next, this CH2 carbon. So X is the leaving group. When the X leaves, we get a plus charge. So when this leaves as a X minus, the carbon gets a plus charge. So to compensate that, this along with its lone pair of electrons moves to this carbon. So the carbocation is formed in the this particular carbon. Now the Z group can come and attack this carbon. So that is the reason the Z group is formed here in this particular case. So a rearrangement leads to the tertiary butyl derivative is shown here. And in this particular case, we have a X group attached to this second carbon. So in this case, the X group leaves. So we get a carbocation here. And this hydrogen moves from this carbon, because in this carbon, if you look at, we have a proton and a methyl group. Whereas in this carbon, we have both methyl groups are present here. So that means this carbocation can be stabilized by the plus I effect of two methyl groups, whereas in this carbocation there is only one methyl group. So this carbocation can undergo rearrangement very effectively. So after the rearrangement, the Z group attacks the carbocation to form the product here. Similar to the hydrogen, the methyl group can also move or shift from one carbon to another carbon during this rearrangement. So in the case of methyl group, this leaves as a leaving group. So this methyl group along with its pair of electrons moves to this carbon. So the positive charge forms on this particular carbon. Now this is again a tertiary carbon. So in the final step, the nucleophile comes and attacks this particular carbon, giving a tertiary butyl derivative. So in all these cases, a primary or a secondary carbocation, if it can get rearranged to a tertiary butyl or a tertiary carbocation, then that happens, that leads to the more stable carbocation. As we had seen earlier also, the stability of the carbocation decides how the reaction proceeds. In the case of SN2 reactions, there is no rearrangement because it is a concerted mechanism. It is a single step mechanism. So there is no ionic intermediate involved in this reaction. So there is no rearrangement possible in SN2 reactions. Whereas in the case of SN1 reaction, we have a carbocation intermediate formed in this particular reaction, which can undergo rearrangement because the stability of the formed carbocation decides whether it will be more stable or not. So here we have an alkyl bromide. This can undergo reaction by SN2 mechanism. It can also undergo reaction by SN1 mechanism. If this undergoes alkoxide, that is ethoxide attack on this particular carbon, so this attacks here on this carbon and this one is lost. So we end up with an ether. So in this case, there is no rearrangement possible. But if instead of that, in the first step, according to the SN1 mechanism, so the Br- leaves in the first step. So we end up with a plus charge. So this methyl group can shift from this carbon to this carbon, leading to a tertiary carbocation on this carbon. So we get an ether which is present here. That is a tertiary ether is formed. So rearrangement is possible in the case of SN1 reaction. Here there are some examples given. The primary carbocation can get rearranged to either secondary or tertiary. And the secondary can also undergo rearrangement to form a tertiary one. So here we have the primary one. There are two primary carbocations are given here. This rearranges to either a secondary or a tertiary, depending on whether it has how many hydrogens. If there are two hydrogens, then the rearrangement of one hydrogen leads to the secondary carbocation. If there is only one hydrogen, then that moves to the next neighboring carbon, gives you a tertiary carbocation. So one thing you have to remember is the group which is adjacent to the carbocation, the protons or the methyl group from this carbon only can move to the neighboring one. If it is far away, then the proton from here cannot move to the carbocation. So for the alkyl and the methyl shifted, methyl and the hydrogen shift to happen, the CH2 should be adjacent to that particular carbon. So in the case of secondary, we can also get a tertiary carbocation by the shift of this proton along with its bonded electron to this particular carbon gives a tertiary carbocation here. So these are all the different ways by which the rearrangement of either primary or secondary carbocation leads to either secondary or tertiary carbocation, which is much more stable. So as I mentioned, in all the above cases, the less stable carbocation rearranges to the more stable carbocation. So this is happening only in the case of SN1 reactions. So what actually moves? A hydrogen atom or an alkyl group migrates with a pair of electrons. So this is what is very, very important. Either the hydrogen atom or the alkyl group, when they move with a pair of electrons from the neighboring carbon to the carbon bearing the positive charge. If it is a hydrogen movement, that is called the hydride shift. If it is alkyl movement, it is called the alkyl shift. And Wagner-Mirwin rearrangement is one example of this one. So here again we have a couple of examples. In this particular carbocation, we have a H plus which migrates to give a secondary carbocation. If a methyl group migrates, we end up with a primary carbocation. So the primary getting rearranged to primary does not happen generally. So primary getting rearranged to the secondary is the most favorable one. And in the similarly here we have the primary getting converted to a tertiary one and to a secondary one. So in this particular case, formation of the tertiary carbocation is much more compared to formation of a secondary carbocation. So finally, when we say the migration of the hydrogen or the alkyl group basically depends mainly on the final, let us say if we start from a secondary carbocation, we end up with a primary carbocation after rearrangement. Here we have a tertiary carbocation after rearrangement. So which one will happen is only this one will happen. This will not happen because the stability is reduced. Primary alkyl cations are less stable compared to secondary, which in turn less stable compared to tertiary. In other words, tertiary carbocations are much more stable. So the secondary carbocation would like to get transferred into tertiary and not to primary. Now we have some comparison between SN2 and SN1 reaction. We are just recapping what we have studied so far. SN2 is a second order kinetics. And in this particular case, we have an inversion happening, we had seen. And there is no rearrangement because it's a concerted reaction. So there is no rearrangement. And the reactivity order is methyl reacts much faster compared to primary, compared to secondary, compared to tertiary. In other words, tertiary undergoes less, the rate of the tertiary conversion under SN2 is very, very less. Or tertiary alkyl halide does not undergo SN2 reaction mechanism. In the case of SN1, they follow first order kinetics because of ion pairs involved in this particular case. A planar intermediate, planar carbocation is involved in this particular case. We see racemization, and here the stability of the carbocation, due to different stability of the carbocations, rearrangements are possible in the case of SN1 mechanism, and the reactivity is tertiary is much more reactive compared to secondary, compared to primary. Methyl does not undergo reaction by SN1 mechanism. Here again we have a comparison between the reaction intermediates. So here we have a non-polar intermediate. So this loses the W group to form the Z, is the incoming nucleophile, gives the inverted product. This is a SN2 reaction, that's a nucleophilic attack. In the case of primary carbocation or the carbocation is formed, then we end up with the racemic product. So W minus is lost, which is the leaving group. This is a heterolytic reaction. So this is a SN2. In the case of alkyl groups, the size of the group is very crucial for SN2 type mechanisms, and the ability to retain positive charge is also very crucial. In other words, the bigger size prevents the backside attack, so the reaction actually proceeds by SN1 mechanism and not by SN2 mechanism. That is the reason the tertiary carbocation can easily stabilize the positive charge. So the bulkier size of that prefers the SN1 type mechanism. And the reverse, that is the smaller size of the alkyl group or the primary carbocations, favors the SN2 mechanism because this is much easier. The rear side attack is very easy in the case of methyl are the primary groups. That is the reason those reactions are preceded by the event mechanism. In both SN2 and SN1, the bond between RX is broken. So if the bond is easily broken, then the rate of reaction is faster. That is applicable for both SN1 and SN2 reaction. In other words, the leaving group X dot or W dot has no effect on the reaction mechanism in either SN1 or SN2 because the leaving group is not involved. And with respect to nucleophile, if the attack of the nucleophile, the substrates in the rate determining step, because in the SN2 mechanism only, the nucleophile is involved in the rate determining step. So the strength of the nucleophile is crucial only in the case of SN2 mechanism. But in the case of SN1 mechanism, it attacks the carbocation. That is a very, very fast step. So the concentration or the strength of the nucleophile does not affect the rate of the reaction in the case of SN1 mechanism. So the concentration of nucleophile or the nature of nucleophile does not affect SN1 reaction, but it affects only the SN2 reaction. So when other things are same, basically the high temperatures, high concentration of the nucleophile favors SN2 reaction and the low concentration favors SN1 reactions. Then we talk about the nature of the nucleophile, whether it is a strong or a weak. So the strong nucleophile attack the substrate at a faster rate in the case of SN2 reactions. And the nucleophilic attacks takes place after the rate determining step in the case of SN1 reaction. So the strength of the nucleophile has no effect on SN1 reactions. In other words, the strong nucleophiles generally favors SN2 reactions and the weak nucleophile favors SN1 reactions. And we already know the leaving group has no effect on either SN2 or SN1 reaction because leaving group does not get detached in the SN2 mechanism because it is already in the substrate only. So it has no effect on the reaction. And in the SN1 mechanism, only the carbocation concentration is too crucial because the stability of the carbocation decides how the reaction actually proceeds. So the leaving group ability also has very little effect on the SN1 mechanism. And in the case of alkyl groups, if we take the bigger size basically favors SN1 mechanism or SN1 type of reactions, then accommodation of the positive charge, that means too many methyl groups plus I effect groups are present, they favor SN1 reaction. And the smaller alkyl group generally favor SN2 reactions. And with the help case of nucleophiles, high concentration favors SN2 and the stronger nucleophile also favors SN2, weak nucleophile favors SN1. So these are all the recap of various factors, the substrate, the nucleophile and the leaving group, how they affect both SN1 and SN2. In the case of solvent effect, we know the SN1 reactions involve carbocations. So they are the ionic species. So whenever we have a polar protic solvent, they can actually stabilize the transition state. In other words, they can stabilize the carbocation also very effectively. So this leads to enhancement of reaction rate for SN1 reactions. So polar protic solvents stabilize the carbocation, thus they enhance the rate of SN1 reactions. When in an SN1 reaction, if the solvent acts as a nucleophile, it is called the solvolysis reaction. Say for example, in this particular case, we have a water. The tertiary alkyl halide lost the bromide leaving group to form the carbocation. So the carbocation is positive charge.
there is lone pair of electrons on the oxygen, so they form a bond and the proton is abstracted by the base, so we end up with the alcohol. So this is how, when in the reaction, the nucleophilic solvent, the solvent itself is acting as a nucleophile. So these type of reactions are called solvolysis reaction. If water is used as a solvent, it is called hydrolysis. So in summary, we will recap what we have studied so far. We studied about the rearrangement of carbocation, because the most stable carbocation will be formed in that reaction through rearrangement. We had seen either 1-2 shift happens with the help of hydride shift, or the methyl group shift happens, due to which the stability of the carbocation, if it is increased, always results. So in other words, what we can say is primary or secondary carbocation can be rearranged to form a tertiary carbocation if the system allows for that particular transformation. Similarly, secondary carbocation can also be rearranged to tertiary carbocation, because the tertiary carbocation is highly stable. One of the reasons for the stability may be the hyperconjugation or the plus I effect of the methyl group. And we also had studied about the various factors that affect the SN1 and SN2 reactions. So basically the strength of the nucleophile, solvent, concentration, how these factors affect the reaction rate of SN1 and SN2 reactions we have studied. With this, we conclude this particular session on reactivity of nucleophilic substitution reactions.